The Bible says, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Enter in his gates with thanksgiving. Hallelujah. And in his courts with praise. Yes, Lord. We are thankful unto him and we're gonna bless him because indeed he is good. And this song says, take all the praise. And I just want you to put your hands together as we praise the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords for his goodness. No matter what the circumstances, we are gonna praise him this morning. Because it could have been otherwise, but he wake you up, you're in your right mind, and so you have no other recourse but to praise him. So we put our hands together. Hallelujah.
I just come to give back to you. Breath. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. With This is my daily bread.
Hallelujah.
This is my
so my soul pant after thee. And when you're panting, it's because you're tired. You've been running, you've been searching. And it's not only for the deer to drink the water, but the deer, Chris, the deer jumps into the water because the lion is chasing him, the predator is chasing him, and the deer is running to get to safety. And our safety is in God. Deer would run and jump into the water and submerge fully into the water and only leave his nostrils out. And when the deer leave his nostrils out, it's just so it can breathe. Everything else is submerged into the water. We got to submerge everything into the Spirit of God today. Our whole body, our whole spirit, our whole soul, and just leave enough room for God to blow his breath in our nostrils. Feed me till I want no fill today.
Fill my cup.
Morning, church. How many know that our Redeemer lives this morning? Who taught the sun where to stand in the morning? And who told the ocean you can only come this far? And who showed the moon where to hide till evening? Whose words alone can catch a falling star? Well, I know my Redeemer lives. I know my Redeemer lives. Let all creation testify. Let this life within me cry. I know my Redeemer lives. Yeah, yeah. The very same God that spins things in orbit
time. I want you to look with me, Sister, you may be seated, Sister Faye. She just read a very interesting psalm, very interesting psalm. It is Psalm 50 and 5. I must say something about the psalm. I want you to understand that all the psalm in the Bible that you can find is 150 different ones. But of this 150 psalms that you may find in the Bible, David did not write all of them. David wrote a few of the psalms, perhaps the majority of the psalm. But there was another guy by the name of Asaph. He wrote a few of the psalms also. And Korah wrote a few of the psalms. And also Moses wrote a few of the psalms. And then we have a few psalms that we don't know really who wrote them. But because David is the sweet psalmist of Israel, And because David wrote the majority of these psalms, we attributed the psalms to David. It doesn't mean that he did all of them. Now, this particular psalm, David wrote it. And what are psalms? Psalms are songs. Are you listening? They are songs. It doesn't make sense or rhyme in the English language because these songs were written originally in the Hebrew language. So if you were to sing them in the Hebrew language, they will match. You will hear the rhymes at the ending and so forth. But because we have to translate it from Hebrew to English, it loses the rhythmic rhymes ending. Amen? So that's why it doesn't look like a song, but they are songs. However, this Psalm 55, David wrote it, and David asked a person to sing it. He asked the chief musician, Aneginoth Miskal, he said, I want you, the chief musician, to sing this psalm. Because this psalm is an expression of a movement that is going on in the life of David. And I want you to listen to it carefully because it's a song. Very hurtful song. And I said, wow, what is David going through? Listen to how the verses begin. Again, it says, give ear to my prayer, O God, and hide not yourself from my supplication. So listen to this prayer of mine, oh God, and don't hide yourself from my supplication. Wait. Number two, he said, attend unto me and hear me because I mourn in my complaint. Are you listening here? I am mourning in my complaint. That means I am feeling dreadfully down. I'm mourning my complaint and I'm making noise. I am praying and I'm making a lot of noise. God, God, God. Because I'm mourning in my complaint. So this is a song, but this song is a song of complaint. It's complaining. Wait, let's read a little bit more and then you will help me here. Now verse 3, he said, because of the voice of the enemy. Why are you moaning and why are you shouting? He's making noise. He said, I'm making noise. And why are you complaining? He said, I am making noise and moaning and complaining. He said, because of the voice of the enemy, because of the oppression of the wicked. For they cast iniquity upon me, and in wrath, they hate me. But David never had a personality problem of people hating him before. Or people, enemy trying things against him. He could deal with that all his life. What's his complaint? What is he making all this noise? He said, I'm making noise and I'm moaning, but I'm making noise. Usually when you're moaning, you're supposed to be quiet. He's making, and he's complaining. Go back a little bit more, just a little bit, and then we run with it. He said, because my enemy hate me. My enemy hate me. And then he said, my heart, look at this, verse 4. My heart is sore, pain within me, and the terror of death are falling upon me. Now, he's getting a little more deeper, right? He said, I got pain all over me, and the terror of death is coming. It's befalling me. That means I'm afraid because death is like they don't want to hurt me. They want to kill me. But David was always a valiant man, never afraid of pain or dying or anything like that. He always a valiant personality. Matter of fact, when David met Goliath and Goliath was walking, David was running to Goliath. What's going on with David here? Well, it gets worse. Look at the next verse. The next verse, he really break down. And he said, my heart is sore pain within me, and the terror of death are befalling upon me. But look at verse 5. You say, fearfulness and trembling are come upon me, and horror has overwhelmed me. Now I am really afraid. I am sinking in terror. Anybody ever get afraid before? Right? But at least you have a reason, right? You have a reason. But we can't find the reason yet. What's going on with David? The guy is terrorized. In other words, he's having something that we call like psychosis. He's afraid. You see his shadow and he's frightened. And any little breeze that blow behind him, he gets nervous. And what's going on? He said, the terror of death is surrounding me. Oh, I feel they want to kill me. They want to kill me. Whoa, my enemy. Which enemies? He said, the one that hate me, they hate me, and they wanna get me, and I don't know what to do. Now look at this next verse, 6. Now he start to say, and I said, oh, that I had what? Wings. Come on, help me read it. He said, oh, that I had wings like a what? Like a dove. And then he said, for that, will I just fly away and be at rest? Whatever is bothering him, whatever is consuming him, is having by the throat, but he doesn't know how to deal with it. And he said, I can't take it. I'm having nightmare. I am terrorized with this situation. I don't know what to do. He said, oh God, I wish I had wings like a dove. And what I will do with wings like a dove, he said, that I could fly away. I just want to fly and be at. But the truth is, you have an ambiguity here. Because if you really want to fly away from a situation, you don't ask for no wings as a dove. You're supposed to be saying, I wish I had wings like an eagle. Because if you want to fly away, you get wings like an eagle. Because no bird on the planet can fly as high as an eagle. And if you really want to get out of it, want to get out from whatever is squeezing you, you ask for wings like a. What do you want wings like a? I mean, you want to get out, but you really don't want to get out. You notice how doves fly? They fly very low from house to house, to house to house, and they fly cool. And they fly in circles and twist. He said, I want to get out of this thing, but I want wings like a dove. So I said, okay, this is the first time David is doing what he have never done before. David always run to the enemy. This time now he want to run from the enemy. And everybody's like, what's going on with David? And I said the same thing too. Until we study a little more and look what happened. Now let's get into it. Verse 7. Lord, then will I wander far off. You ain't going too far if you get wings like dove. But he said, then will I go on far off and remain in the wilderness. He said, I will hasten my escape from the windy storms and tempests. Destroy, O Lord, and divide their tongues. Right? For I've seen violence and strife in the city. Da 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 da. And then it reached to verse 12. Verse 12 now is going to tell us what's really bothering him, Sister Barnett. And that's why we read the whole thing. Look at verse 12. In verse 12, he says, for it was not an enemy. So we thought it was some enemy messing him up. He said, no, it was not an enemy that reproached me. Then I could have borne it. He said, neither was it that hated me, that did magnify himself against me, then will I have hid myself from him. But it was you. Now we're becoming what? Help me? Personal, right? He said it was thou, you. Who, you, who? He said it was you, a man my equal. You that have the same rank as me. He said, a man my equal, my guide. You, the guy that used to guide me, my acquaintance. Who is he talking about? You, my guide, my acquaintance, my equal. We took sweet counsel together and we walked unto the house of God in company. You that counseled me, you that advised me, and you gave me sweet counsel together. It wasn't an enemy, it's you. Then he wished some bad things. It's called imprecatory prayer. Then he said, may death grab you and squeeze you, etc. But then look at verse 16. He said, and as for me, I will call upon God, and the Lord shall say, who in the world troubled David? Wouldn't you ask that question? Who troubled David? You remember a song? I think that song, I've heard it sing by Jamaican people too. I remember the night I met you. You remember the song? When we said that we will never part. But now you're leaving, taking and leaving me. What a way, y'all know the song, boy. Know it good. Don't know three verses in the Bible, but you know that one good. But it's all right. No. It's good. Right? Wouldn't you say that the guy that made this song is hurting for something? Does he sound like a happy person singing this song? You say, well, who is he making the song for? Which one of these women leave him standing? Somebody mess him up. But we don't know who. You don't know who. Right? And the same thing David is saying. My heart is in pain. And inside of me, I'm hurting. He said, oh God, if I could only have wings like a dove, I'd just fly away and get out of this. But now I'm stuck here. I can't even run out to the desert. I have no wings. I'm stuck. And then he said, and it was you. Said, if it was an enemy that did this to me, I wouldn't mind. You know? He said, even if it was somebody that I dislike or dislike me, I don't mind. But it's you. Who? You? My equal. My guide. My. We went to the house of God and you gave me sweet counsel. And you do me this. And I said, wow, David is really hurt. Listen, friendship and hurtfulness, we will always have. And I'm coming. I know you're waiting. I just love the suspense. And I just love, oh, you're looking at me with the suspense. But I'm telling you the truth. Everybody needs friends. Everybody needs a friend. Amen or no amen. Amen? Everybody need a friend. Even Jesus Christ had friends. Jesus had apostles, he had disciples, and then the Bible said he had a friend. His friend was Lazarus. And I want you to notice something. For Jesus Christ, friendship was higher than ministry. Because he never made Lazarus one of his disciples. He never made Lazarus one of his apostles. But he made Lazarus his. He said, that's my friend. You listening to me? And many years later, 3 years later, when they were supposed to graduate, he graduated the disciples and graduated the apostles. He said to the apostle, you will not be called apostles or disciples anymore. He said, now you are my friend. That means he uplifted them from apostle to friend. Why? Because friend is a closer intimacy than just being colleague in ministry. I hear somebody said, and I think I heard Bishop from New York said, who is a friend? He said, a friend is a person that you can think out loud in their presence without fear and without censorship. And it is really true. Because right now we don't know what one another thinking. We don't know what you're thinking. And you could never know what I'm thinking ever in your life. And I don't know what you're thinking. But some of us, if we were to think out loud, they'd put us in jail. Because the kind of stuff that we'd be thinking sometimes, we'd be like, oh my God, Father, in Jesus' name, rebuke that out of my mind. We don't know what we think, but a friend is a person that you are not afraid to think out loud in that person's presence, because the friend will at the same time help you. It won't condone you, but won't condemn you either. But you can feel rest and assured to think out loud in their presence. Amen. Don't you have friends? You never have a friend. And you know what, too? A friend is a person that will not tell you what you want to hear. A friend is the person that will tell you what you need to hear. And sometimes we confuse friendship with a person that is tolerant to us. Sometimes we confuse that friendship. We think because the person telling us things that we like to hear, oh, that's my friend. No, that person is not helping. That person might be hurting you. And sometimes, I tell you the truth, sometimes you need a friend that will call you and put you in a corner and straighten you out in the corner and tell you, shut up and sit down. You can't do this, you can't do that. Shut your mouth. I don't want to hear it. And then you're like, how dare you? Well, I'm your friend, I can tell you. David now had a friend. He had a friend. And David had a friend that was his counselor. Are you following me now? And this guy was David's good friend. He was such good friend with David that when he saw David for the very first time, he loves David. Because David had a thing inside of him and upon him. David had a kind of a personality that he could draw love out of everybody. I mean, David will walk by pass, and the young ladies, the young maidens of Israel will see David passing, and he will have such a charismatic effect that the knees will go to buckling. He just had that charisma. He just had that personality. He could draw love out of women and men too. Doesn't mean he was funny, but people just love him. Wouldn't you like to be like that? But people just love you. I tell people the same thing. I say, wait till I pass by 3 times. You're going to love me so much, you won't even know what to do with me. Yeah, but that's it. David, he was that kind of personality. He was a very friendly, charismatic person. So he made good friends with this guy. That is his partner. And the guy loved David. Love him to death. Who is this guy? And all of a sudden the guy double-crossed him and treason set in. And David is hurt because his friend double-crossed him. The name of his friend is Ahithophel. His name is Ahithophel. I don't know if you ever heard about this guy, but his name is called, you see it there, Ahithophel. And you see the first 3 letters, Ahi is Hak. Hak means brother. In English, they translated A-H-I. Hak. But Hak means a brother. It means a strong fence. So Ahithophel was like a brother to David. But his name means brother. And you see that Tophel. That word Tophel means simple. So brother to a simple. Oh, he's the brother. And that word simple is a word that is used all the time for a person that is like a fool, a dummy, simple. So who was Ahithophel? Ahithophel was a wise man in Israel. Perhaps the wisest man that Israel ever produced. His name was called Ahithophel. And his brothers were beside him. Simple. Brother, a brother to the simple. That's his name, Ahithophel. Who was this Ahithophel? And why David is having a fight with him? Because Ahithophel is the best person. Well, let me just give you a little background, and then we can get out of here, and we get to the point that I'm trying to get to. Ahithophel was David's state secretary, or secretary of state. Ahithophel was to David what Henry Kissinger. You remember Henry Kissinger? Some of you, the older folks. Henry Kissinger was the Secretary of State of the United States when Nixon and Ford was president in this country. President Nixon, President Ford. And what's so great about this Henry Kissinger? Well, Henry Kissinger was so good at making peace and pulling nations that were enemy to the United States. Henry Kissinger was so good at brokering peace and deals with America. They even call Henry Kissinger the Antichrist because he was so good. Vietnam, when Vietnam was fighting with America and America wanted peace with Vietnam, after all the fights that Vietnam had with the United States, all of that, who went over later and broker a deal of peace? Henry Kissinger. Matter of fact, listen to this. The New York Times, in one of the trips that Henry Kissinger was doing, I don't know if he was going to China, because he also made a deal with China. But while he was going on one of these missions, the New York Times wrote, well wishes to Henry Kissinger. And you know what word they use? The biblical word. They say, while he's on his Ahithophelic mission of grace. You see that? New York Times, they use the word Ahithophel. They say Kissinger is going on his Ahithophelic mission. Ahithophel. Let me say a little bit more, then we can leave. Ahithophel came from a place called Gilead. You ever heard of Gilead? What is famous in Gilead? The balm. You remember that? The balm of Gilead. Mm-hmm. Mm. Well, Ahithophel come from Gilead. And one thing we can't doubt about is that Gilead is the place that have a special balm, right? Special ointment. This special ointment that come from Gilead, if you put it on, it will soothe your sores. It will pull out the misery out of your joints and pains. This balm, Gilead had a special balm that when you rub with it, it kind of pull out misery. It pull out pain. It soothes and quiet nerves that are agitated. That's Ahithophel. Ahithophel in his very nature, that's the nature that he had. And when you understand where he came from, you will say, now I understand why he's like that. He comes from Gilead. So in his nature, his inherent being is balsamic in his nature. Anytime Ahithophel comes in any place, he soothes and pull the misery out and quiet situation. Wait. They said Ahithophel was so good. that after David will fight and win the war, Ahithophel will go and win the peace. Why? Because he will go to these little tribes, these little country, these little groups. And I tell you the truth is this too. When you beat up on a person and they are humiliated and you drag them down, it's very difficult to win peace with them. But he will go and speak to these people that David squashed and pull them out of that misery and bring forgiveness and reconciliation between those little cities, Philistines and all these other groups, and bring them peace with David. Let me go a little bit more further. They said the counsel of Ahithophel was so strategic and so good. They said that the counsel of Ahithophel was like the counsel of the inquiries of the oracles of God. In other words, when you didn't even know what to do with your enemy or how to fight or what them to do, you could ask God and God will tell you. They say you could ask Ahithophel, and by speaking to Ahithophel, Ahithophel was like the oracles of the gods. The guy was so good in joining together, bringing peace, brokering smoothness, and feathers that were ruffled, Ahithophel will come in and smooth off the feathers. The guy was a peacemaker. It was in his nature. Anywhere he go, he just brought peace and brought people together. The guy was the best thing. And let me tell you, he was so good at it that David could never be the peacemaker that Ahithophel was, or the statesman that Ahithophel was, and Ahithophel could never be the king that David was. It just shows you that God have different people to do different things, all for the benefit of the kingdom. So the kingdom don't depend on one person or two persons. God have different people pull the kingdom through. Amen? Amen? Yes. Are you cool? Uh-huh. But now this is the thing that happened. David have a son. All right. And I'm glad you're listening to me quietly, but David have a son. And the son is a rebellious son. Are you following me now? Yes. Hallelujah. I just put on my other mic because I'm going to finish with this now. Now David have a son. But his son is a rebellious son. The son is so rebellious, the son killed the brother. You're listening to this, right? David's son. His name is called, help me with this mic. His name is called Absalom. Anybody hear of Absalom? That's David, rebellious, bad son. But Absalom, if you can't hear me, I'll go back to this thing. Am I all right? I just want to finish with it now. Now, Absalom killed his brother, the elder brother. But the reason that Absalom killed the elder brother is because the elder brother raped the sister. And when the brother raped the sister, David, his father, didn't do a thing about it. All David, the father, did to Absalom, to the elder brother, was give him a little slap on the wrist. But he never chastised him for raping the sister and then throwing her out in the street to die. Absalom couldn't stomach it. So Absalom went and rescued her. And then Absalom said, I'm going to kill you because you did this to my sister. And the thing is that she and Absalom, they were brothers by mother's side, but not by that other brother's side. He was only a brother by father's side. And he raped the sister. Absalom invite him to a party, and in the party, when he forget all about it, and he's drunk, Absalom kill him. Now look at the difference. When Absalom kill him, Absalom run and hide. David say, I don't want him. I don't want to see him ever again in my life. Absalom had to run and gone. So now Absalom is gone, right? 1 year pass and 2 years pass, and somebody came and tell David, you're not going to forgive your son? It's all right, he can come back into the city, but he will not see my face. Over a year and change passed, and David won't speak to Absalom. You see that? He forgave the big son, but when Absalom killed the big son for doing wrong, Now you want to chastise this one. I don't know what kind of family you grew up into. But if you grew up in a family like me, the little one always get away with murder. Or the little one is the one that get all the chastisement. In my case, I never get away with anything. In my case, I got all the whooping, the slapping, the throw. They just didn't throw me over the balcony because I wouldn't jump. But, you know, everybody grew up in different family, right? But because I'm very hyper, the truth is when I born alive. I'm so sorry for some of you that had to slap you into life and keep pumping you to live. Not me. For my come out, I said, where are we going? Come on, let's get on it. Let's get it on, baby. Come on. What's going on out here? What's all the excitement? It's just me. No, but that's what. And then I live my life like that. I just live until I run into Jesus Christ. And Christ changed my heart. Christ made a new man out of me and saved me. And said, can you don't use all that energy for the kingdom of God? And I say, here I am, Lord. I will use every drop for your glory. Because I know people, they hack outside in the world. And then when they come to Christ, they. No, the same energy you had for the devil, now you're going to use it for Jesus Christ. What makes you believe that God wants dead people? God wants live people, strong people, firm people, holy people, righteous people, ready to do anything for the kingdom. Wait. So Absalom rebelled against David. And now Absalom wants to kill his own father. Absalom did everything and even took away the kingdom from David and ran away with it. We good until there? Well, guess what? Absalom wanted to kill his father. And Absalom made a strategy, a coup. And in the coup, he deposed David from the kingdom. Knocked him off the king. And Absalom took over the kingdom. Who's sitting on the throne in Jerusalem? Absalom. Who running the country? And where is David? He's running. But why is he running? Because David know Absalom could not strategize this by himself. Who is helping Absalom? Ahithophel. Ahithophel all in a sudden join Absalom. And Ahithophel have David hot. He run there, Ahithophel over there. He run back here, Ahithophel over here. He run that, Ahithophel. I mean, David, Ahithophel had him hot. That's why David said, oh, I wish I had a wings. I can't run away from this guy. This guy's too good. Something went wrong somewhere, right? Wouldn't you like to know the whole story? Wouldn't you like to know what in the world David could have done to this guy? That Ahithophel joined his own son and have him hot. David couldn't sleep the same night, two times in the same place in two nights. He couldn't because Ahithophel had him figured out. Listen, in one occasion, Ahithophel said to Absalom, take your father's wife. Go into your father's chambers and take his wife and go outside and sleep with her publicly. Go up the tower and sleep with your father's wife at the top of the tower and let everybody know that you are cutting ties with your father. And that's the best way. Let them see you take your father's wife and you sleep with her. And Absalom went and do it. And then David heard about it. Absalom came down and said, I did it. Ahithophel said, you have him now. Guess what? Tomorrow your father going to come and he's going to try to do this, come this side. You're not going to go that side. You're going to wait on him over here. And when your father pull over here, you're going to come over here and you're going to block him in this side because he's going to come because you touched something that you should not have touched. You went and sleep with his wife. Hey, Ahithophel had the whole strategy. Well. And David said, God, I can't fight this guy. I can't fight him. He's a genius. He knows. But Lord, I have to call upon you. Lord, I don't have anybody else. Look, my own enemy, my own friend who gave me all the counsel. Look all the things he's doing to kill me. God, he said, God, help me.
confuses counsel. You see what he pray? He said, I know my son Absalom is behind him. I mean, is with him. Confuses counsel. And that same day, there's a man named Hushai. Right? Another prophet man. And the guy came and said, Absalom, what Ahithophel told you to do? He said, he told me to go over here and cover this side and come around because my father going to come through that hole and I can catch him over here. Hushai said, don't do that. I know your father too. And your father know that you're going to be waiting on him here and there. Don't do that. Go underneath and wait for him over the next side. And Absalom did that. Went under and wait on the next side. And David came exactly where Absalom said he was coming. Where Ahithophel said, David did the same mistake. But Hushai told Absalom, don't wait there, wait over here. And David didn't come over there. When Ahithophel heard that Absalom disregarded his counsel and followed the counsel of Hushai, Ahithophel said, what? Are you crazy? I see you. Ahithophel went out, the Bible say, and hung himself. Kill himself. You know why he did it? Because he said, definitely, David won't kill you now. And when he finished killing you, they're going to kill me. And I'm not going to give him the pleasure of killing me. I'd rather kill myself. And he went out. And Ahithophel hung himself. And you know the rest of the story of Absalom, right? He got caught by his hair. Joab killed him. And then David cried, oh, my son, my son, my son, my son. But if it wasn't for Absalom, for Ahithophel, none of that would have happened. Now what's going on? I just wanted to bring you to this to show you something. Now come with me. Come with me, please. And just read two scriptures, just two, and then we can go home. In 2 Samuel chapter 23 and verse 34, and you can remember 2, 3, 4, right? 23, 34. So 2 Samuel chapter what? 23, 34. In 2 Samuel chapter 23, 34, it says that Ahithophel, listen, sister Barnett, it said that Ahithophel had a son. Are you listening to me? And the name of the son was, you have it there, Eliab. Are you reading that? It says Ahithophel, Eliam. Ahithophel had a son, and the name of the son was, see there, Eliam. Are you here? Who had a son? Ahithophel. See his name? You see, it says Eliam, the son of Ahithophel the Gilonite. Right? Good. Good so far? Now come with me to another scripture. In 2 Samuel chapter 11. 2 Samuel chapter 11. 2 Samuel, come on, we're going to do this right away and we finish with it. 2 Samuel chapter 11. Are you good? Verse 3. 2 Samuel chapter 11 and verse 3. It says now, all right, I need your help with this one. Look over here, over the side first. What's the name of Ahithophel's son? Eliam, right? Ahithophel had a son and the name of the son is? Eliam. Now, Eliam have children, right? Let us see what's the name of his children. Now, look what it says. Look what it says. So David sent and inquired about the woman, right? And then he said, and someone said, is this not who? Bathsheba, the daughter of who? The daughter of who? Eliam, the wife of Uriah. So who is Bathsheba's father? Who is Bathsheba's father? Eliam. And who is Eliam's father? Ahithophel. So now you see that? Now you know why Ahithophel is upset and hate David. Because David messed up Ahithophel's granddaughter and killed the granddaughter's husband, his grandson-in-law. Oh, you don't get this yet. Now you see what's going on. But want you to notice, Ahithophel, Eliam's father. Eliam, Bathsheba's father. David messed up Bathsheba's life. David killed Bathsheba's husband. David took away Bathsheba from Uriah, the husband. David committed the wickedest crime because he gave Bathsheba's husband a letter to kill himself. You see that? David. But now David is running. Now David is crying. Now David is saying, I wish I had a wings. I wish I had a wings like a dove. I will fly away. I want you to notice something. We never want to say the full story. We always say the story and the half that is convenient to us. When you read Psalm 55, David said, my enemy running me down. You, my equal. You, my counselor. My own friend. Oh, we are sweet. You see, not one time he's saying what he did. He's talking like if the guy just came out from nowhere and running him down and hate him and don't like him. But when you read here, now you know it's more the stuff. I heard somebody say it. Every story have more than one side. Are you listening to me? Some stories have over four sides. Your side, his side, God's side, and the right side. But you see, even David writing his Psalms, you see that? He don't say everything that he did, you know. He don't say a thing. Oh, me. Oh, poor thing. Pray for me. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord, oh, Lord, oh, Lord. Help me. Help me. Poor thing. No, poor thing, nothing. Oh, somebody have to help me. Are you getting the picture now? And all of us men, that's the way we act. We always set a part of the story that make us look good. And for us, we are always a victim. We never done anything wrong. It's always the other person fix me. It's always the other person don't like me. It's always the other person trying to saw under my foot, cut the ground under so I can fall under. Hallelujah. And I tell you the truth, it come out in the wash all the time. It always comes out where? In the wash. What David did? David took that man's wife, and it was more hurtful because that man loved David. The man's name was Uriah, Bathsheba's husband. You see, Bathsheba's husband loved David. He wasn't a Jew. He was a Hittite, a black man from Het, the black folks. Bathsheba, Bat means daughter of Sheba. And Sheba, the queen of Sheba, Africa. Bathsheba, black woman and a black man, brown-skinned girl. Oh, sugar and spice. I mean, she looks so good, but she's not your wife. She belongs to Uriah. The black man had a nice wife, and David didn't have enough. He could get any wife he wanted, but no, he wanted his best trusted bodyguard. You see that? The bodyguard wife. And he killed the man and take away the wife. Get her pregnant, and then to hide the pregnancy, he married her. And the Bible said God get to know it. And God was displeased with it. I'm here to tell you something. When people do things to you, you don't have to run down to try to get even to nobody. You need to keep your mouth quiet. You need to keep yourself quiet. People do you bad. The Bible says, don't render evil for evil. People slander and talk, you shut your mouth. People pull the rug from under you, you try to keep your balance. The Bible says, pray for them that despise you and evil you speak against you. Just you pray for them. Why? Because you are not God. And God can get even. Some people are living with a situation in their life even right now. Some people living with things because they swear, I'm going to get back to her. She think I forget. I have it right here. How many times you hear people saying that? I have it where? I have it right here. She think I forget. He think I forget. I got, no, you can't have it nowhere. You belong to Jesus Christ. And you have to learn to turn it over. You see, Ahithophel also made some mistake. Because when David messed up his granddaughter, and when David killed the granddaughter's husband, when David did all that mess to Ahithophel's family, that thing hurt Ahithophel to his body, to his loins. How this guy, I give my life for this man, and look what he did to me. It hurt him. But he's the man that always pulling people together. He didn't know how to forgive. But he always teaching people that they should. He was the best pulling people together. But when he had to walk through that situation, he didn't know how to forgive. And you see what's going on? He don't know how to forgive. And at the same time, now he wants to play God. Because when God saw what David did, God said to David, you're not going to die, but your family going to suffer. Your children will suffer, and your wife's going to make a spectacle out of them, and other people going to come and take away your wife just so you took away somebody else's wife. And God said, punish David. God said to Nathan, tell him, I'm not going to kill him, but I'm going to punish him. Yeah. But when Ahithophel heard, Ahithophel said, it's not enough. Ahithophel felt because he wronged me, I have to get even with him. So Ahithophel wasn't satisfied with the punishment of God. Ahithophel feel, I got to punish him too. I'm telling you, if somebody do you wrong, you have no right. You can't touch nobody. You can't discipline nobody. You nobody father or mother, and even if you were, you can't take things in your hand. You have to learn to put things into the hands of God. Look, one thing with David, he was screwed up and messed up all over, but David knew how to forgive. Hello, somebody. I said David knew how to forgive. When Saul did all the wickedness and tried to kill him a million times, each time David had the opportunity to kill him, David said, I can't do it. I will not touch God's anointed. I will not lift a finger. Many times they had Saul in a position where David could kill and wipe him out. David said, I will not do it. Why? He said, as God anointed, I have to forgive him. There was a man, a crazy man from Benjamin. He cursed David, cursed him and cursed his family and cursed his children. And one time while he's cursing David, David is walking, and one of David's mighty men pull a sword and say, King, you want me to kill this dog? David said, no, don't kill him. He said, let me kill him. He's cursing you. He's cursing your children. He's cursing your family. Let me kill him. David said, no, forgive him. And he walked away because he knew how to forgive. And he knew that he is not God. And the only one that have right to withhold forgiveness or to determine whether you will forgive or not is God. And then I hear people say, but pastor, you don't know. You don't know how that thing hurt me. You don't know how they did me this and did me that and do you that. Good. But God is still saying the same. I am the Lord, your God. Hallelujah. And he said in Mark chapter 11, read it for yourself. He said in Mark 11, when you stand to pray, you're supposed to do one thing first. Mark 11, 25. He said, 11, 22, he said, have faith in God. But when you stand to pray, he said, the first thing you need to do is forgive. And then he said, and your Father, which is in heaven, will forgive you the way that you have forgive others. Then he said, and with the same measure that you measure, it shall be measured back to you. But then he gave a warning. He said, and if you don't forgive men their trespasses, your Father which is in heaven will not forgive you of your trespasses. What will that do to you? If God don't forgive you, that means you are in your sins. When you pray and if you are in your sins, God cannot hear you, right? Because you are in your sins. 1 John 3:22. Look what he said, 1 John 3:22. And we know that if we obey God, he will hear us. And if he hear us, we have the petition. 1 John 3:22, he said, we know that we get from God because we have obeyed his commandments. And what is one of these commandments? Forgiveness. Forgiveness. We don't have a better church. We don't have a better church because we wrestle with that thing called forgiveness. Yes, we do. But that's the one sin. Forget about stealing and robbing and committing adultery and fornication and all these things. There's one little thing that we do. James 4:17 says, it is called the sin of omission. It says, for him that know to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. So you have a lot of people in the church in sin, but they don't know. They think their sins are forgiven. But your sins are not forgiven if you know what's to do good, but you did not do it. And when you withhold forgiveness, God withhold forgiveness from you. It said, "As forgive us our sins as we forgive them that has sinned against us." And it is amazing. It's always the person that know how to bring others together doesn't know how to bring himself together with others. Ahithophel, the best brains in Israel, is called a peacemaker. God could have blessed him and helped him, but he refused to forgive David. David lied on the man. David said half truth, even write the Psalms against the man, and don't say the whole story. Even put how nice he is, and sweet counsel and all these nice things. But he didn't say none of the wicked bad things that he did to that man, to the man's son, and to the man's granddaughter. He never said a word about it. There's nowhere in the Bible David is saying, I did all this mess. But he talk about the guy, bring him down to the ground. But now it comes out in the wash. So what? So we need to learn to forgive. Ahithophel mistake, he couldn't forgive David. David mistake, he never was truthful to the guy. He double-crossed the guy. And you know God punished David for that? God made David lose his children. God made David lose his wives. God made David run all over the place and the enemy run him down. God punished David many times for that. But he was still merciful to him because he knew David had a heart to forgive others. And each time God wanted to kill him, all right, I beat you enough, I give you a break. God showed mercy for David. Today, God wants to pull us together. Are you listening? He wants to pull us together. And the only way we can be pulled together is if we're willing to do what? Forgive the person. And if nobody did anything to you, better yet, I've forgiven you in advance. So if tomorrow you do something, you're forgiving already. How about they say this and they say, ah, yeah, 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 yeah. They will always be saying, he talk about it in Psalms 55. He said, their tongue is crucifying me. He said it in verse 2. He talk about the people's tongue. When I was younger, they say, cut eye, can break my bones. You remember something like that? Yeah, that's what it goes. Cut eye, something like that. I go. Oh, can't cut me in two. That's why some people cut eye, cut eye. Because people like they cut their eyes and cut eye, cut eye. And stick and stones. All kind of fancy things. I don't remember all of it, but I know some of it was there. But what we have to learn is this. People gonna talk, people gonna do things, people gonna slander, people are gonna hate you, people not gonna like you, people gonna dislike you for nothing that you have done. But your job, the Bible says, when you stand to pray, you forgive. You forgive. You what? Forgive. Mark 11, he said, when you stand to pray, you make sure and you forgive. Because he said, just as you forgive with the same measure that you measure, it will be measured back to you. And I am convinced there is nothing that anybody could do to you that you haven't done already to God. So people will mess you up. You mess up with God many times, and God forgave you. And we have to do the same thing. Is forgiveness good for us? Yes. Because the more we forgive, the more God will answer to our prayers. The more we forgive, when we pray for you, you'll be walking. When we pray for you, you'll be standing up out of that wheelchair. When we pray for you, your eyes will be better. Your heart will be functioning better. Your body will be what? God will begin to bless us even more. Why? Because we have a church where God hears and answer to our prayer. Because with the same measure that we measure, he will measure us.